Hi everyone, good evening. Warm welcome to the class. I can see many students here, Kavya, Lali, Arvind, Tasneem, Manish, Shanti, Radhakrishna. Welcome to the class. I hope your study is doing very well. Have a good revision of each and every chapter with our support. Hello Shivani, hello Shriar Lakshmi, Shri Hari Murthy. So today we are starting our second session of organism and population. I hope those who were absent in the session first of this chapter have covered the session already. So today I am starting the session with the responses to abiotic factors. I have already given the introduction for this chapter and the topic major abiotic factors we have gone into detail. Soil, light, water and temperature already I have covered. So today in this session I am going to cover responses abiotic factors, also the adaptations, the morphological changes and behavioral changes. So those all kind of adaptations with the help of few examples we are going to learn about these, and the introduction of the population subtopic we will be covering in this session only. So here is the topic for today. The main topic which we are covering today is response to abiotic factors. So in the previous session we have seen that we have the abiotic factors as well as the biotic factors. Abiotic factors, these are all non-living factors or the physical factors which are present in our surroundings, and in an ecosystem it is very essential to have an balance between the abiotic factors as well as biotic factors. Biotic factors are the living factors like plant, animals and the microorganisms, and they have a continuous interaction in the environment with these abiotic factors to sustain a self-sufficient or to be able to live as a self-sufficient system. So the question is that how do the organisms which are present in the environment or which are living in an environment in different kind of habitats, because the habitat is not the same for all the organisms. If we go to the altitudes or the latitudes, or if you go to the different temperate zones of the earth, yes, there is variation in the temperature, there is variation in the precipitation level. Somewhere the at the poles the conditions are very hot, can be extreme hot weather, and it can be extreme cold water. So how the organisms are managing to live in those kind of habitats? So these are the stressful conditions. So how do the organisms living in such habitats cope or manage with the stressful conditions? So in this, the main mechanism is the homeostasis, like regulation of the internal environment constant. So the fitness of a species in a particular environment means the well-being of a species in a particular environment depends upon the efficiency of all physiological and biochemical processes in the system. It is very much essential to have the efficiency at its max so that the organism can sustain in a better way in our surrounding in the stressful condition. So there are some animals which can regulate their temperature. Are we humans are able to regulate our temperature, or are we having a constant internal environment? So some of the animals maintain their body temperature or osmotic concentration, which is known as the osmoregulation. So there are some of the animals which can maintain their body temperature. They have no variation in the body temperature if the external conditions are too cold, or if the external conditions are too hot. There are some animals, if the surrounding is very hot, then their body temperature is going to be increased. If the surrounding is very cold, their body temperature is going to be decreased. So they are not regulating. They are constantly changing their internal environment. So based on that, there are two kind of organisms. Some are the regulators and some are conformers. And the category of in between these two, which can maintain for some level, but automatically after some time they are just changing their internal environment. So these are the partial regulators. So what is this homeostasis? Homeostasis is the condition when the organism is able to maintain a constant internal environment. So this is called as homeostasis. So their performance is maximum regardless of the weather condition outside the body. So if you see, in we are using air conditioner in summer and heaters in winters. Why? To work efficiently. Okay, so better adapted in the environment. So this is an artificial medium. This is an artificial way to maintain our in our surrounding. But the animals have some natural means, mainly physiological, to manage such stressful conditions. So if we take the example, here is the word thermoregulators and there is the word thermoconformers. Okay, so thermoregulators, they are regulating. Okay, listen carefully, they are regulating their internal conditions to have a constant internal environment or to have a constant internal temperature. There is not varying temperature. So these are known as regulator, thermoregulator. And there are the organisms which are changing according to the surrounding. So they are the thermoconformers. Now there is another important term, that is osmoregulation. So in osmoregulation also, there are osmoregulator and there are osmoconformers. Okay guys, so there are three categories of animals that have specific ways to respond to external environment, means about the abiotic factor. So depending upon the mechanism adopted, they are classified as number one is conformer, number second is regulator, and number third is partial regulator. So if I am giving you an example of a fish, you must have heard about the fishes living in the fresh water and migrating to sea water, or the fishing living in the sea water migrating to the fresh water. So these are the adaptations. But there is, like we are taking an example, there are two fishes. And one is present in fresh water, another is present in salt, sea water. So I am asking you, in previous session I have given you the salt concentration in the fresh water and the salt concentration in the sea water. What is it? What is the salt concentration? If we are taking the salt concentration of the fish which is present, or which we are taking example like it is 20% the salt concentration. We are now talking about the osmoregulation. I am giving an example because the students have a confusion about sometimes. So, and this word generally come, what is osmoregulation? How they maintain their homeostasis or the internal environment. So what is the, who is going to write what is the salt concentration in the fresh water and it is in the sea water? We can assume, or we know that the salt concentration is more in sea water. It is, yes, Srivatsan, welcome to the class. We are talking about the conformers, regulator and the partial regulator. Okay guys, so what is the salt concentration in fresh water? It is very less, around 5%. And sea water, who is going to write? Guys, please respond. What is the salt concentration? This is very, like in previous session also we gone through this. It is generally 30 to 35%, and we cannot ignore the small data which are present in our NCERT or in the content which you are following and the content which we are giving you. For these small data, sometimes you may find a direct question. So in each and every class, I always give the emphasis of learning the data which are present in our books. Because you may find a direct question sometimes from the data. Okay, either in the form of they will give you a ascending order, they will give you a descending order, and they will say that fresh water, it is this water, this. And the salt concentration will be given, then you have to choose from this. So this is the significance why we should learn each and every data which is provided in the books. Again, I am saying all the data which are present as it is, you have to remember, you have to learn. So this is the fish which is present in the fresh water, guys. Okay. And this is the fish which is present in the sea water. Now, how it will regulate itself? Third condition we can take, where the fish is not regulating itself, what it will do? Either it will lose the salt concentration, and by losing the salt concentration, it will go up to the level of 6 to 8%, near to the 5%. Or first, the water concentration, water will go from the dilute to, because we are talking about osmosis, dilute to higher side, and the salt will go from the higher to lower concentration. Okay, so one case is that it is not regulated, it is the directly conforming. Direct the case of conform, it is making the salt concentration somehow equal to the 5% by just eliminating the salt concentration. So this is not regulation. But if this fish want to maintain the internal environment, or we are taking this as an example of regulator, so it has to regulate the internal environment. What it will do? The salt will go from higher to lower concentration. The water will go from dilute to concentrated. Okay. So what they have adaptation, what they are doing? They will eliminate the urine which will be hypotonic, and they will not drink water. They will not drink water, and as the salt is going outside, there will be active absorption of ions by chloride cells. So this is the mechanism how this fish will regulate in the fresh water. So same in this case, because the salt concentration is outside higher, it is 30 to 35%. Inside the body of the fish, it is 20%. So the salt will go here and the water will come outside. So what it will do? It will drink water, and there will be pumping out of the ions by the chloride cells. Okay guys, are you getting? I want a response. Are you getting this example or not? I have given you example of three fishes. The one fish which is present in fresh water, the another fish present in water, and the third fish which is not regulating, which is just using the salt and taking the water and just confirming, maintaining it by means of variation in the internal temperature. But these are the two examples by means that the fishes are regulating in the present conditions. Okay guys, this case is the urine will be hypotonic. They don't drink water, there will be active absorption of ions by the chloride cells. While here the case will be reverse. They will drink water and there will be pumping out of the ions to maintain a homeostasis. So this is an example of how the homeostasis is maintained or how the osmotic regulation is done. So this is the chart which is given, responses of the organism to stressful conditions. Here the three lines are given, and this question has been asked as such as it is the examination already. So the all the charts and the graphs are very very important. What about the others? Kavya and Shanti Radhakrishnan. About the others, the other one in the class, is it clear? Osmotic regulation. So here you can see these are the external level, these are the internal level is given. So this is the line conformers. They are changing, varying with the external conditions. As you can see, the regulators, conformers, they are just varying with the external conditions. The regulators, they have a constant internal environment. They have a constant internal environment. And there are some organisms which have a category where there are the conditions are not permanent. Like they have some unfavorable conditions, they have sometimes favorable conditions. Like the birds, they migrate to the other region for the breeding time, for the breeding period. So there is migration also, and there are suspending of the activities during the unfavorable conditions. Like we have seen in the plant kingdom, there are the organisms which exist in the form of spores. Okay, and these spores germinate during the favorable conditions. Guys, or also we can see the example in the form of the planktons. They can exist in the form of a cyst, and during the favorable conditions they just become active, or the dormant stage of the seeds, dormancy in case of seeds. So what are these? These are all the conditions when the conditions are not permanently unfavorable. So there is migration for some time. To and migration is what? To and fro movement of the organism from one place to another place for some time. When the conditions are unfavorable, when the extremely low condition, low temperature is there, then the birds migrate to the other place and they return back to the same place after the breeding. First, for breeding, the photo period is very very important. They do not have that photo period in the that environment. So they just go to the other place, which is the breeding period for those birds. Because the photo period is very very important for the activity of the gonads. I hope these examples are very much clear with you. I am moving to the next topic, conformers. So here is the content for all this. Explanation I have given. Majority of the animals, up to 99%, and nearly all plants. So in plants there are less chances of regulation, as they cannot move and they cannot maintain a constant internal environment. They just change. There is variation according to the surrounding. So their body temperature and osmotic concentration changes according to the surrounding conditions. Such animals and plants are known as conformers. And most of the plants, they are conformers. First, the thermal regulation and the osmoregulation are energetically expensive process. They have to regulate. They have to change everything to maintain a constant environment, as we have seen the example of freshwater fish and the seawater fish. That's why such a vast number of animals have not adapted such ways to maintain a constant internal environment. And it is still more difficult for the smaller animals who have larger body surface area. Kavya, the question which is asked, it is generally from that graph. It is the direct questions. They will eliminate the marking because you do not have vary options in that. Conformers might be in place of conformers. We have not seen these kind of questions, but just the question which we have seen in the previous examination, that is the direct question from this. But the aspect is important in kind of mechanism. First, the question which nowadays are coming, you may find if three questions are coming from the ecology unit or the four questions are coming from the ecology unit, you may find two questions which are logic based and two questions which are the direct question on the basis of the examples. So might be they will ask you not from the conformation. They will ask you the example. They will give you a name of a plant here. And they will give the partial regulator. They will give the bird names here, Siberian birds. Or might be for the regulator, they give the name of the humans. So from that, the kind of question you may get. But previously, we have seen the question from this graph which is coming directly. Okay, Kavya, is it clear? So for logic-based question, the theory, which the examples which we are giving, and the line to line of the NCRT, the terminology they are giving, the lines they are giving are very, very important, because the question is, the logical questions are coming. Then there are the questions like, which of the two options are correct? Or mark the choice which have two right options. Like if A, B, C, D, four are given, then you have to go for the right two statements. So for these kind of questions, these are the logic based questions. Okay, Kavya, I hope this is clear with all of you. So it is more difficult for the smaller animals who have larger body surface area in comparison to their volume. So like the animals which are present in the colder region, they want to be warm. They do not want to seize their energy. So for this, they want a smaller surface area to volume ratio. But the animals which are present in the warmer region, they have a comparatively larger surface area to volume ratio. That is the base of the Allen's rules also. We are going to discuss this. Such organisms tend to lose their body heat very fast when it is cold outside and expend much energy to the body when it is hot outside. So this is the main reason why very small animals are rarely found in the polar region. So second example is of the regulator. Regulator homeostasis. I have given the explanation for this also. So all the birds and mammals which are homeothermic or the warm blooded. There are two types of cold blooded, the warm blooded. And if poor lower vertebrates and invertebrate can maintain a constant body temperature and constant osmotic concentration regardless of the surrounding conditions, they are, because they are regulating themselves. So their physiological activities, biochemical activities inside the body are very important to have a maximum efficiency. Humans, the example of this regulators is another example. How the humans are able to maintain a constant body temperature of 37 degrees Celsius. Because when it is hot outside in summers, we start sweating, primarily for cooling the body. And when the surrounding temperature is lower than the body temperature, like in winters, we start shivering. And the muscle contraction produces heat to rise the body temperature. But the plants, they do not have such mechanism to maintain their internal temperature. That's why they are placed in the category of conformers. Yes. Pacific salmon spends most of its life cycle in marine water and moored in fresh water. maintain a constant solute concentration in its body by osmoregulation. We have seen this example by the previous, with the help of the example which I have given, the fish present in the salt water as well as the fresh water. So partial, another third category is the partial regulator. As I said, if the stressful external conditions are localized or remain only for a short duration, they are not permanent. So the organism has two other alternatives. They don't have to do much of the physiological changes. They just will move to another place for some time period to avoid the unfavorable period. Second thing is the suspension, suspended activity. So based upon the situation, in the stressful conditions, if this is localized or for some time, the partial regulators may proceed for migration or for suspension of body activity. So they migrate or can move away temporarily from the stressful habitat to a more hospitable area and return when stressful period is over. The most prominent example here is of the birds. Okay, the example here, the birds. And just note down the example of osmoconformers. There is one exception also, an osmoregulator. Osmoregulators, all the aquatic vertebrates are osmoregulators, but there is one exception, that is hagfish. This is a osmoconformer. Okay guys, note it down. All of the aquatic vertebrate, these are the osmoregulators, but there is one exception, which is the hagfish. Okay, and most of the osmoconformers, all the aquatic invertebrates. So example of prominent example of migration, it is birds. During winter, undertake long distance migration to more hospitable areas. As I said, in case of birds, why they move? First of all, the photoperiod is very short, the extreme cold condition. So they just move towards the plain too, by means of the long distance migration. And this photoperiod is very, very important for the activity of gonad. Okay, so this migratory place is the breeding place for them. After some time, when the conditions are favorable, they just move to the same place, to their native place. So this is a prominent, like the Siberian birds. Okay, so migration, it can be classified as, why it is important? First, from this Caesarean rhythm of animals, there is diurnal migration, there is metamorphic migration. So diurnal migrations means these are accordingly rhythmic migration, like in days, because of the very hot temperature, they just hiding of the rat, mice during the day and become active at night. And also in case of some planktons, zooplanktons, they just come to the surface of the water. That is known as the Caesarean rhythm. And the question has been asked in AIIMS on this. Why the zooplankton? What is the activity? Then the zooplanktons come to the surface and after 12 hours, they move to the bottom of the water. So this is associated with diurnal migration. Second thing is the metamorphic migration. These are the movements from one habitat to another during different stages of life cycle of animal. Okay, so from one habitat to another habitat during the different stages of the life cycle of animals. So prominent example which is very very important, there are anadromous fishes. Know the name, there are catadromous. Who can give me example of anadromous and catadromous? Anadromous, they just move from fresh water to sea water, and catadromous are the fishes which move from sea to fresh water. Okay. Example of anadromous is the eel fish, and example of catadromous it is the hilsa. Note it down, guys. This is also very important. Anadromous fishes, this is a kind of metamorphic migration, while the diurnal migration that is associated with the rhythmic movement of the animals. The example of zooplankton, that is the circadian rhythm. Okay, you should not be confused with the circadian cycle. Sometimes they have given like it is circadian rhythm or circadian cycle. It is, the actual word is circadian rhythm. Okay, when, so there are two type of fishes, anadromous, catadromous. Anadromous fishes which migrate to fresh water and from sea to fresh water, from fresh water to sea water, these are anadromous, and from the sea to fresh water, these are catadromous. The example is hilsa. Here the example is the eel fish. Then another category of the migration, that is the periodic migration, and this periodic migration is generally for finding feeding grounds. Like the prominent example of the periodic migration, that is in case of the locust. They just migrate to different feeding grounds when their population increasing and the feeding capacity of their living area. Fourth one is the annual migration. This is the annual migration of the organism according to the environmental changes, or it can be latitudinal or the altitudinal migration, coming to the ground, going to the places. Second category of the partial regulator, that is the suspension of body activity. So during the unfavorable conditions, there are some organisms like the lower plant, fungi and bacteria, they have just thick spores. They just exist in the form of the spores, and they germinate during the favorable condition. When the environment has the favorable condition, they have the right atmosphere outside, they have the right moisture, and they have the nutrients to grow, they germinate. And another example, suspension, that is the dormancy stage of the seed during the unfavorable, when the right oxygen level is not there, right moisture is not there, and right temperature is not there. The seed goes into a inactive form, that is known as the dormancy. Yes, Kavya, I am taking your example because time is running short. I am taking the taking this periodic migration at the last. Okay, I have noted it down, Kavya. And reduce their metabolic activities when the conditions are favorable, and form new plants when the moisture and the temperature conditions are suitable. How some animals are there, they do not want to migrate or they cannot migrate. So how they just avoid the stressful conditions for the time period. So that is the escape in time. There are two terms. Kavya, I am taking your example also. One is the hibernation. You must have heard about the hibernation. Second thing is the estivation. Okay. So the animals that cannot migrate. So how they will avoid the stressful conditions. So like escape in time for some time period. Either they go hibernation. Hibernation means in winter. That is also known as winter sleep. Okay, they just go to the caves and burrows. And during for a longer time. And the estivation, this is known as the summer sleep. Like this is seen in snail and few fishes also. So what is this hibernation? Hibernation is the movement of the organism or going of the organism inside the caves to avoid the unfavorable very low temperature. And estivation is hiding into the burrows, like it is known as the summer sleep. They do not migrate to the new place. They just living in the same area but avoiding the stressful condition by going into the summer sleep or in the winter sleep. Third thing here is very important is these are the adaptations. So what are adaptations? They are the morphological, physiological or behavioral changes that are enable the organisms to survive and reproduce in their habitat. Because every organism want to be alive. No one want to be affected by the very stressful outside conditions. Every organism want to be alive. So there are some organisms which are not migrating or suspending their activities for the unfavorable conditions, but they have adapted themselves by making some changes in their body over a period of time. So there are morphological, physiological and the behavioral changes that enable the organism to survive and reproduce in their habitat. Production is very important. That's why they can grow, a population can grow or a species can sustain. So the behavior of temporary migration to avoid unfavorable conditions or the suspension of growth and development and reduction of metabolic activity, all these are the adaptations. You see, the migration, that is also an adaptation. And suspension also is an adaptation because we are adapting by various means in the environment. So, prominent example is of kangaroo rat. For example, we are taking here the example, some examples first. So one of the most important example, it is of the kangaroo rat. Kangaroo rat, it is found in the North American desert where there is the scarcity of water. Okay. But as there is very, very less water content, but they are able to cope. So they have some adaptation in their body. How they are managing to get the water if the water is not available for a longer period, because they have the oxidation of fat. By the oxidation of fat, they are getting the water, and this water is known as metabolic water. Number one adaptation. How? Second, they just drink very less water. It is a kind of adaptation in them. And as they are ureotelic, but they eliminate very, very less amount of water. So these are the kind of adaptations which are present in the kangaroo rat. It is in the absence of an external source of water, the kangaroo rat, which are found in North American desert, capable of meeting all its water requirement through its internal fat oxidation, in which water is a byproduct. And second thing, and this water which is gained by means of the oxidation of the fat is known as the metabolic water. It also has the ability to concentrate its unique, concentrated unique urine has a very less amount of water, so that they can minimize the loss of water through urine. And they are ureotelic, but they just eliminate a minimum volume of water. Second is thing in the xerophytes. The plants which are living in very harsh weather where the temperature is always high. Temperature is very high always. They have a long duration. The photo period is long. So how the plants survive there? They have some special kind of characters in them, so that the plant is able to survive in xerophytic extremely hot weather. Many desert plants have thick cuticles on their leaf surface. The example you can take of the Opuntia cactus. So they have a high thick cuticle on their leaf surface, and their stomata, these are arranged in pits. What is this? Like in generally, the stomata are present. If this is the epidermis, the stomata structure, you can see these are the bean shaped, can be found this. But in case of xerophytes, the structure is like this. They have a pit in them, and in pit these stomata are present, so that these are known as sunken stomata. So what are these sunken stomata? They have a pit in them, and because of this pit, they are just minimizing the water loss. If the water is losing, because this is the process of transpiration by which the plant loses its water. Water is very essential for the growth of the plant, growth and development of the plant. So, for sustaining the life, they have to minimize this water loss. So, for minimizing, guys, so for minimizing this water loss, what they have some adaptations. Like if you see the structure, they have the leaves have the are present. They have the spines, so that there is the minimum of the transpiration, and they have this sunken kind of stomata. The stomata are present in a pit, so that the water is collected in this pit itself in the form of the vapors or the moisture, so that there is the minimum loss. Third, they have a special photosynthetic pathway, that is the caseous acid metabolism, which you have must read in photosynthesis chapter. In this metabolism, the stomata, these won't open in day, and they are remain closed during the daytime, and they are open during the night time, and they just accumulate CO2 for the process of photosynthesis during the night. And this adaptation is also for to minimizing the loss of water. Okay guys, is it clear? Here the leaf, either the leaves are reduced, either the leaves are changed into the spines, or CAM is the caseous acid metabolism. The plant which live in very extremely harsh weather, very extremely dry condition, they have alternate pathway, that is known as the CAM pathway, in which the stomata remain closed during the daytime, and during the night time they just open up. So these are the mechanism by which the xerophytes are able to survive in the extremely dry condition. Okay, is it clear? Some desert plant like Opuntia have no leaves. Either the leaves are reduced or they are absent. used or modified two spines. And the photosynthetic function is taken over by the flattened stem. They have a green stem. They have branch anatomy, two type of renal and agronal chloroplast. Okay, we are not going into detail. I have given the points which are very much important for xerophytes and the kangaroo rat. The examples are very, very important, both the kangaroo rat as well as the xerophytic opuntia. Another important term here is the Allen's rule. Okay, Allen's rule. Mammals from colder climates generally have shorter ears and limb to minimize heat loss. To see the example of two dyes, like it is assumed, one is having the surface area to volume ratio that is like 20 and it is 20.5, like assuming. So this is how, like, surface area to volume ratio is very much important. So in case of the mammals which are living in the colder climate, they want to minimize the heat loss to be warm, so they tend to have a shorter surface area to volume ratio. But the animals which are present in the warm weather, they just want to release a lot of heat to be cool, as they are already present in a warmer climate. So comparatively, they have a larger surface area to volume ratio. So that's why they have shorter ears and limbs to minimize the heat loss. Okay guys, this is called as the Allen's rule. Another adaptation, like in polar seas, aquatic mammals like seals, they have a thick layer of fat that is known as bloomer below their skin that acts as an insulator. And it reduces loss of body heat, keep their body warm. They have a thick layer of fat which is known as bloomer. Okay, so these are the prominent examples in case of adaptations. Allen's use also we can see. This is a desert fox with a long ear loss. Why this is a polar fox which has a shorter ear loss? Okay, is it clear? Is it clear, everyone? And Kavya, periodic migration is nothing. It is not very important. Periodic movement is the movement, the general movement. Periodically, they are moving from the colder to the hotter region, from the hotter to the colder region. The simple migration, that is known as the periodically they are moving from one place to the another place. So the things which are important, that is the diurnal, because the example is important here, and second the example of the that fishes, also the example of the birds. And one more important is, do you know the name of the new name of the Bharatpur sanctuary? The Bharatpur sanctuary, which is very, very famous for the migration of the world, and these kind of questions also asked in the examination. What is the new name? Who is going to write the new name for the Bharatpur sanctuary? Here, what is the new name for Bharatpur sanctuary? Bird sanctuary. This is important. Every year thousands of birds like the Siberian birds are coming to India, especially in the Bharatpur bird sanctuary, and here we have a new name, and this new name is the Cuyo National Park. Please write down and note it down, everyone. The questions which were coming earlier for Bharatpur Bird Sanctuary was coming with the name of the Bharatpur Bird Sanctuary, and this is the example of the migration, or these are the breeding place for the migratory bird. The example is the Siberian birds. But the name has been changed. Name is the Cuyo National Park. And another important thing, that is the diapause. You may find some question with the term diapause. Yes, it is Sriharimurti. Very nice. It is Cuyo National Park. You have to remember this change also. Allen's rule. Diapause. Can you, any one of you, explain what is diapause? This is the term. Already I have given the explanation. But the term which is used for the suspension of, note it down please, zooplankton, because this also has been asked, plankton activities in the form of cyst during the unfavorable period. That is known as diapause. During the favorable condition, they just germinate. Just come into the active form. Okay. Another very small topic, that is the altitude sickness. Altitude sickness is nothing but when we are going to the higher altitude, then because of the scarcity of the oxygen, the RBCs are not able to bind properly with the hemoglobin. So because the body compensates low oxygen availability, because of the just increase the RBC. So some organisms possess adaptation that are physiologically when which allow them to respond quickly to a stressful condition. And this is the symptoms for these are the nausea, fatigue, heart palpitation. This is because in the low atmospheric pressure of high altitude, the body does not get enough of the oxygen. And this is known as the altitude sickness. But gradually you get acclimatized and stop experiencing altitude sickness. So how our body compensate? Our body compensate low oxygen availability by increasing the RBC production, decreasing the binding capacity of hemoglobin, and by increasing the breathing rate. Okay, so this is the small topic of the altitude sickness. Also a kind of adaptation, how the humans which are going on the high mountain range, how they are dealing with this stressful condition. Now coming to the topic population. What is a population? Shown several times. Population is a group of individuals, so I am not giving much of explanation for the definition of population. Is a group of individual. Guys, listen carefully, this session is very very important, and the coming session, first from this chapter most of the question has been asked from this session, and tomorrow I will be taking the population growth curve, logistic growth, exponential growth, then the interaction between the organisms. And I hope you have a, I want you, all of you have a good revision at home also. The population is a group of individual of a particular species. Know that the group of individuals of the same time or the organism of a particular species can interbreed together and live in a well dignified geographical area, they form a population. And when the same geographical area is inhabited by two different population, then they form a community. Okay. So these are the examples of population, like tigers. All the tigers which are present in a national park, they are forming a population of tigers. Rats in an abundant building, these are the population of the rats. Lotus plants in a pond, that is the population of a lotus. and the frogs also present in the pond. That is also an example of the population. Teak wood trees in a forest, it is also an example of population. And bacteria present in a petri dish. Petri dish means when we are growing the bacteria on a growth medium inside the laboratory, providing the same natural condition. So that is forming the population of the particular bacteria. So what is important in population? Our population have certain features or the attributes. What are these which are not represented by the individual? As an individual, we are not able to define them. First, life expectancy, sex ratio, birth ratio, death ratio, and the age distribution. These are the different attributes of the population. So in this, the birth ratio is very important and the death ratio is very important. First, for a population to be growing, there should be balancing between the birth and the death ratio. Sex ratio, the number of females, the population over a number of males. So first one is the birth or the natality rate. What is the natality rate? It is the birth rate. So how you can calculate them? It is the number of births per 1,000 of a population per year. Number of births per 1,000 of the population, that is per year. And this birth ratio can be represented in percentage per capita or per individual. What is the birth rate? Like if you have, there were 50 lotus plant in a pond last year. This year the population is increased to 58. So the birth per capita will be 58 minus 50. We are taking it for a year. So it is 8. And the number of population at the earliest, it was 50. So birth rate is 8 divided by 50, 0.16 offspring per lotus per year or per capita birth rate per year. This is how we can calculate the birth rate. Okay guys, now these are the small things which I am taking, because the last 10 minutes I am going to cover just the generalized view. The most important things from the population I will be covering today. Okay, this might be I am faster, so I will repeat these things tomorrow because the time already is done and we have to take some questions also based on the today's session. Death or the mortality rate. Mortality rate is the death rate. It is the same. The number of deaths occurring in a population of 1,000 per year. If it is a 50 houseflies are there, the population at the initial 5 died. So how you can calculate it is 5 divided by 50. So this is the death ratio or the mortality ratio. So a population is affected by the four factors: emigration, death ratio, death rate, and the birth rate. Overall, we'll be discussing tomorrow. I am little faster here because we have to take questions also. So tomorrow I will take this two slides once again. Another attribute characteristics of a population is the sex ratio. Like 60% of the population are females and 40% are males. This is just. Important thing in the population, we have the age pyramid. How a population can be defined by means of the pyramids. So how a pyramid can be plotted? The age distribution percent individual of a given. There are three age groups in a population. If you see a population, there are three age groups. Okay, so one which are pre-reproductive, those which are in the productive phase, and third is the post-reproductive. all we are taking in response to a female category, like free reproductive when they are not able to do the reproduction, and productive age which are capable of going into the phase of the reproduction. And third is the post reproductive, like in case of females, the having the menopause already. So there are three categories: pre reproductive, reproductive, and the post reproductive. So if you see a population, there are more number of reproductive, and there are lesser number of post reproductive. So automatically, there will be more younger. It is a growing population. Assumption I am taking. So on the basis of these, the shape of the pyramid reflects the growth status of the population, whether it is growing, whether it is stable, or whether it is declining. Okay guys, so there are three forms, like expanding or growing. You may find the word growing, stable, and declining. Can you give me where the age group is even? Neither pre-reproductive, neither post-reproductive are too much. As in this case, the population is growing. For the pre-reproductive are much higher in number than reproductive and the post-reproductive. And pre-reproductive are going into the reproductive, but the declining number, the post-reproductive, is less. So the expansion, is expanding. Here the age distribution, it is even. It is a stable population, or very expanding pre-reproductive, nor declining pre-reproductive phase is here. So in case of the declining population, if you see the pre-reproductive, these are lesser than they have the reproductive. But if you compare the reproductive with the post-reproductive, then you can see here it is like, we go for reproductive by upper thumb and by lower arrow, these are the post reproductive. So the age group of post reproductive is higher. The age group for the post reproductive is higher. So this is the kind of population, is the declining kind of population. Okay guys, tomorrow I will also give these with the help of some examples. Tomorrow we are taking only the population growth curves and some interaction in the time period. Okay guys, is it clear everyone in the class? This topic is very interesting. Have a revision. If you like the session, you can show a thumb and also like the videos, and you can share with your peer group and the friends. Now we are taking some questions here. Regarding temperature and osmotic concentration, are plants are. These are regulator, these are partial regulator, these are conformers, these are escaper in time. All of you in the class, is the session is clear with all of you? If you have any doubt, you can write to me, and we can have also, if you have any doubt, in tomorrow's session. And have a reason at home. And also, again I am saying NCERT, line to line, very must to do for everyone, must as the NCERT, it is said to be the Bible for need for biology. Every line, every diagram, every graph, very very important. 85, sometime 95 or 85-90% questions, and the question having a complicated terminology, find it only from the NCERT. So understand, because NCERT you cannot train it at such. You have to understand the topic very well, first of all, by means of, like we have done theory today. So if you have understanding of the topic in your mind, then you can learn very easily. It will be very easy for all of you. So whatever content I have covered in session first and session two, for your benefit, I am saying again, must have a revision of all the content and must have line-to-line revision of NCERT also be successful. Okay, guys. So it is conformers. Already we have enough of discussion on this regarding temperature and osmotic concentration. Nearly all plants are conformers. What about the others? Answer of the question. What about the others? Apuntia does not have following adaptation. Apuntia or the adaptations in the xerophytes. We are talking about a xerophyte. The leaves are reduced to spines. The function of photosynthesis is taken up by succulent stem. The stomata remain closed during the day. The pathway of photosynthesis is through C3 cycle. Which of the following one is not according to the adaptations found in the xerophytes? Guys, I am waiting for the response for this question. Apuntia, we have seen enough of the examples. I have moved to question number 2. What is the answer for? Yes, Shivani. Yes, Sri Harimurti. Kavya, the answer for question number 1, it is 1C. And now it is question number 2. Apuntia is a xerophyte. Just now we have discussed the adaptations found in the xerophyte to survive the extremely dry conditions. The leaves are either reduced or modified into the spines. So it is right. The function of photosynthesis is taken up by succulent stem. Yes. In succulent stem is there. Thick stem is there which perform the function of photosynthesis. Stomata, they remain closed during the day. Stem. Pathway is there. The pathway of photosynthesis is through C3 cycle. No, they have C4 cycle. They have Krange anatomy. They have two type of chloroplast, granule and agranule. Shanti Radhakrishnan, the succulent here is given for the thick stem. Thick greeny stem they have. But they have C4 cycle. Okay, the answer for this is 4th. Yes, it is 2D. Kavya, very nice. Tashneem, very nice. Sri Harimurti, very nice. C.R. Lakshmi, very nice. Shivani, question number 3. Which statement defines the Allen's rule? Aquatic mammals have blue fur as insulator. Mammals of colder climate have shorter ears and limbs. Mammals of humid and warmer region have more melanin in their skin. The bears undergo hibernation during the winter. This is winter sleep. So Allen rule is direct. Mammals of colder climate have shorter ears and limbs. What should be the answer? I am waiting for the response. I am waiting for the response. Everyone have to take care of health also. COVID is still here in India. So be happy. Please. Your studies, eat well. Stay away. Here, have safe environment around you. Question, yes. The mammals of colder climate have shorter ears and lips. For question number, yes, it is B. For question number 3, they have shorter ears and limb. Mice heat loss so that their body can be warmer. Which of the following is most convincing reason for increasing population growth in a country? High birth rate, low mortality rate, low population of old people, high population of young people. Why is waiting for the response high birth rate? There is high birth rate, but may or may not be able to survive for longer time. It's not a low mortality rate, like death rate is low. Low population of older people. If there is low population of older people, then it is a expanding population. And if there is higher population of old people, then there is declining population. High population of young children. What should be the answer? Like I said, the higher birth rate is not essential to have a high growing population. It is not a sign of growing population. The young child, they are going into the reproductive phase. So it is an expanding population. Like if the pre-reproductive is higher, what are pre-reproductive? Those, the high population of young children is pre-reproductive. Okay, so you have to see how you have to attempt the question. High birth rate is not a sign of the growing population as it is, because it is, if there are not better, maybe high birth rate is there. Low population of older region. If this is the low population of older region, older people, and there is high population of young, but we are talking about the growing population, expanding. Although it is expanding, but these are the high population of the young children. They are going into the reproductive phase. Okay. See, Kavya, in all the four options, we have to choose the best correct option. If these two will not be given, then you may go for high birth rate. If it is given, then high birth rate is not a correct answer. But low population of older people is also not a sign. It is going for the expanding population. But the high population of the young children, they are entering into the reproductive phase. We have three categories. There is pre-reproductive, there is reproductive, and there is post-reproductive. So this low population of post-reproductive is actually representing the post reproductive kind of category of from the population, and this high population of young children are actually the pre reproductive, which will be going into the reproductive phase. Okay, so ultimately the by the process of reproduction the population will grow. So in these kind of questions we have to see the most accurate option from the available choices. Some student during a study caught, marked and released 80 fishes in a pond. Initially there were 80 fishes in a pond. Later 100 fishes were caught at random. What they have taken? They have taken 100 fishes randomly and 40 to be marked. Initially these 80 were marked. So what should be the accurate, most approximate number of fishes in the pond? Avya, Shri Harimurti, Shri R. Lakshmi, Shivani, Shanti Radha Krishnan and all others, Arvind, Tasneem, Shri Vatsan, Shri Harimurti, everyone, I am waiting for the response. How you can calculate these kind of questions? How you can you have to, there are questions like this. You have to write the what they have given actually. You just need to be careful about the statement. Okay, so 100 were caught. That's the number of fishes DX. And out of 100, 4 were marked. So it is 40% of 100. 40% of X of 100 is what now? Because X was the, we are taking as the number of fishes sent in the pond. X of 80, because initially it is given 80. We will not take 40% is from 100. We have caught 100. Out of these, we found 40 as marked. So this is 40% of X of 80 per earlier. Because marked totally were 80. So 40% it is 10%, it is 20 of 80. So 100% it is 200. Are you getting it? How you will calculate this question? Is the question number, this is clear? Question number 5 is clear? How we can calculate the answer is 200. We will assume the number of the fishes like X. Initially what we have marked 80. But we have caught 100. So this 40% which is marked is of 100. So it is 40% of the 100 fishes. But we have to taken from the 80, this marked one. So it is 40% of X of 80. 10% it is 20. If we go for 80, it is 20. So for 100%, it is 200. Okay guys, the answer is C here. Is it clear? The answer is C here. Certain characteristic demographic features of developing countries are high mortality, high density, uneven population growth and a very old age distribution. High fertility, lower rapidly falling mortality rate, rapid population growth and a very young age distribution. High fertility, high density, rapidly rising mortality rate and very young age distribution. High infant mortality, low fertility, uneven population growth and very young age distribution. So what should be the answer for question number 6? And be quick in answering your questions. Question number 6. I am waiting for the response for the question number 6. They are giving the demographic features about the countries. And these are the developing countries. Here we are talking about the developing countries. So in developing countries, what about the others? High fertility rate is there because in developing countries generally the population is very high. The population number, like India is a developing country. If we take the example of our country, we have a high fertility rate, but we have the low or rapidly falling mortality rate. The rat rate is comparatively low. We have a rapid population growth and very young age distribution is there. Okay, so answer 6, it is 2. 6B. Yes, all of you have given the right answer. Tashneem, Shri Harimurti, Kavya and Shivani. It is right. Question number 7. Moving to the question number 7. And be quick in giving your response. What is true about the isolated small tribal population? We are talking about a isolated small tribal population. There is no change in population size as they have a large gene pool. This is a small population, so they have a small gene pool. Okay guys, there is a decline in population as boys marry girls only from their own tribe. Hereditary disease like color blindness from like mother to son cannot spread. This is also not true. Can be spread. It is a hereditary disease. There can be spreading of the color blindness. Wrestlers who develop strong body muscles in the lifetime pass this character on to their progeny. So, acquirence of the inheritance of the acquired character, the theory given by the Lamarck was rejected. Like if someone is fat, that need not necessary that the progeny will be fatty baby. So it is also wrong, and they do not have a large gene pool. So what should be the answer? Yes, as it is isolated, we are talking about a isolated, as they are not interbreeding with the other population or the other species. So the decline in the population and the boys marry girls only from their own tribe, not from the other population. So the answer for question number 7, it is B, which is very much correct, given by all of you. Very, very nice. So I am expecting each of you have a very good, wonderful session with me here. And tomorrow, your educator Vinita will be available with another session, that is session 3. And we have some important subtopics there to be discussed. Okay, guys. Thank you so much. We are meeting tomorrow. Do hard work. You will get success for sure. Stay at home. Stay safe. Manage your times. Give time equally to chemistry, biology as well as physics. And do a lot of revision. No worries. Bye-bye. Take care. Welcome. Bye-bye. Take care.